Hello, CUBE community. Welcome back to Black Hat 2025 at the Mandalay Bay in Las Vegas, Nevada. I am your principal practice lead and security analyst and favorite media host for theCUBE, Jackie McGuire. I am very lucky to be joined today by Deepen Desai. He's the your title is
EVP Cybersecurity.
Make sure I get that right. And we are here to talk about your ThreatLabz 2025 ransomware report. You showed me some of the figures from it, and they're a little bit staggering. Even, I mean, I think we've been living in ransomware and, you know, the whole, since it seems like COVID, this has been a huge thing. So you would think that the growth would level out at some point, but that has not been the case. So let's talk about some of the key findings. What surprised you in the report?
Yeah, so I'll start by sharing the premise on this report. You're right, we've been doing this for 5+ years now. This is our annual research report where we take into account things that we're seeing in Zscaler's cloud. This is one of the largest cloud where we're protecting thousands of global customers. Just to give an idea of the scale, we're seeing close to 500 billion transactions daily. We're extracting 500 trillion signals from it.
And 500 billion transactions daily.
Yeah, that's what we're securing for these global enterprises. Now, every year, the team will look into you know, the intel side of the house, the telemetry of what is being blocked in the security cloud. And the annual report that you see published will account for attacks that were successfully blocked in the cloud across different stages of the life cycle, as well as the tracking that the team does in the wild. So there are more than 250 prevalent families that the team tracks. Some of these are ransomware families as well. And the goal over there is to understand the TTPs that these threat actors are leveraging and publish it, share it with some of the best practices that the organization should follow. So that's what the report constitutes. It's telemetry from Zscaler Cloud, as well as in the wild activity of these attacks that the team is tracking in order to make sure we're evolving the platform to protect these organizations that rely on Zscaler. So the key trends, I mean, ransomware, as you mentioned, we've been living this since pandemic and even before, actually. Yeah. Before pandemic, we saw WannaCry, NotPetya, right? Yeah. Those names kind of made it like, okay, this is a big problem. But then there were multiple trends that we saw. You know, initially they were encrypting files, then they started encrypting and exfiltrating data. So that's what we used to call double extortion. More recently, and this is something that we've been observing from last couple years now, ransomware families are not doing encryption. So they're just exfiltrating data. And that's one of the key trends that we highlighted in this year's report as well. They're not just exfiltrating small amount of data, they're exfiltrating large volume of data. We saw a big spike in that as well. The report highlights 238 terabytes of data stolen from these enterprises that were successfully attacked by these ransomware operator. The volume of attack also went up. We saw about 146% year-over-year increase in number of ransomware attacks that were seen against these organizations that we blocked in Zscaler Cloud.
What do you think causes that increase? Do you think it's that, you know, AI and those types of tools are making it more accessible to people? Do you think that because it's become a very profitable industry, more people are getting into it? Like, what do you think is behind this incredible increase?
All the things that you mentioned, actually. Yes, all of the above. Look, it's a business operation. They are going through their own level of transformation as well, and I'll mention a couple points over there. But there are multiple things. One is, yes, it's very, very lucrative. I mean, every successful ransomware attack that these guys are able to carry out, the ransom amount is worth it for them to go through the entire life cycle. There is also this ransomware as a service infrastructure play where, you know, there are experts that are very good at infiltrating an organization. We call it initial access broker groups. So Scatter Spider is an example. There are multiple others. Their goal is just to get inside the organization, establish that foothold, and then they will rent ransomware as a service infrastructure from these ransomware operator in order to carry out very sophisticated scale ransomware attacks. They don't need to be an expert at doing what typical
ransomware.
You can
just go buy a login on the dark web, buy ransomware, and then deploy it, and you really don't need to have any level of hacking skills to do this, right?
That's, yes.
It's kind of terrifying to think about, and I had, you know, this has kind of been a theme over the last 6 months as I've been writing, is like, attackers aren't breaking in, they don't have to. They're just buying your credentials on the dark web. They're already out there, and for you might not want to think this, but many of your employees use the same password at work that they do on their personal devices. And so when one of those info stealers takes that, it's pretty easy to get somebody's credentials.
So you're right. Stolen credentials are important, but they're definitely taking it further using AI, which you mentioned as well, where an example that I plan to demo in one of my talks over here at Black Hat as well is, they will identify 5 to 6 privileged employees at an organization. They will then spam them with email saying, hey, there was an unusual login activity with the intent of phishing for their creds, phishing for their account credentials. But then within 5 minutes of those email going out, they will get a call from AI help desk. So this is a cloned help desk that is calling the employee saying, hey, there was an unusual activity. You must have received this email, do A, B, and C. And that makes it very, very difficult for these employees to distinguish between, okay, is this real? I mean, the security awareness training that at that point is very, very important. It needs to be updated. Mm-hmm. And then also prioritizing a zero trust framework becomes very important, because you need to assume that that employee may make a mistake and that identity may get compromised, that asset may get compromised. Yeah. What's the security from that point onward? So that's where the zero trust piece comes in.
Yeah, I know when I was talking with Jay at Zenith, he was saying, you know, you just have to assume you've been compromised. Like, because you have. And the dwell times have gone from a couple months to like over a year. It's hackers are patient. You know, they'll breach you and they'll just wait. They'll wait for an opportunity. I guess let's talk about zero trust a little bit. When we're thinking about this, all of these crazy spikes and, you know, successful attacks and the amount of data exfiltrated, what's the low-hanging fruit there that you typically think are the first couple things that you need to address?
Yeah, so look, when I talk to my CXO peers, I always use the 4 critical stages of the attack when they're planning their zero trust journey. Mm-hmm. Zero trust it has become a buzzword that many of the vendors are abusing, but at a fundamental level, there are 3 principles. One is, you know, never trust, always verify. That's where the identity piece comes in, the posture piece comes in. Mm-hmm. Least privilege access, that's the access control. Adaptive access control, which is risk-based, very, very important. And 3rd is assume breach, which is where assume compromise fundamental comes in. Now, with those 3 principles in mind, you should look at 4 stages. One is reduce your external attack surface. Mm-hmm. What can you do to reduce the number of opportunities that these bad guys will have, whether it is, you know, one of the asset that is exposed that may be targeted due to a vulnerability in it. Mm-hmm. Or 2nd is, of course, those VPN appliances. So legacy architecture with threat actors are significantly increasingly targeting using zero-day attacks. So preventing that external attack surface becomes important. 2 is preventing compromise. Mm-hmm. This is where applying consistent security control, no matter where your users or assets are, whether the user is traveling, whether the user is in office, very important. 3 is eliminating the lateral propagation phase. So this is when I say assume breach, what we mean by that is I would tell the CXO that I'm talking to, like, if your laptop were to get compromised, what all things is exposed from that point onward? So making sure you have truly implemented zero trust architecture with segmentation, where you're not bringing users on the same network as the crown jewel application.
Yeah.
Very, very important. So containing that blast radius using segmentation is important. And then the last thing is everyone is after your data. You're seeing that even in case of ransomware, they're like, they don't need to encrypt your files. They don't need to cause business disruption. They just need to steal your data. Mm-hmm. And even then, their chance of getting successful ransom payment has gone up. So
really?
Yes,
it's interesting, because I think we had seen that trend go the other direction for a little while, right? Where companies were not paying ransom anymore because their cyber risk insurance companies were telling them not to. So is this flipping the other direction now? That's really interesting.
Well, the trend on ransomware operators moving away from encryption to exfiltration is definitely increasing. The trend on whether to pay or not to pay, it's always mixed. But we saw 70% more victims year over year this time just by looking at those leak sites. To give you an example, like there was this healthcare company that decided not to pay ransom. I'm not trying to,
you're not advocating one way or the other. We're not giving you insurance advice, ransomware advice.
Exactly. They didn't pay ransom, but then they were hit with multiple lawsuits, compliance violations, and they ended up paying only five times more than the original ransom demand. And then ransomware operators will use these type of public cases to then convince the victims.
Put pressure on other people,
Hey, if you don't do this, look at what these guys suffered that didn't pay ransom. So that area, you're going to see more and more of this. And AI is playing a role across different stages of the attack, whether it's that initial compromise where they will do things that I mentioned, making AI do that phone call, or doing internal recon or doing data exfiltration. So they're able to move fast if they want to, or if they want to just sit in the environment, observe for the right opportunity, they can do that as well.
Yeah, and I want to plug here, so, and I talked to Jay about this, I think we talked about this at RSA, zero trust is not a product, it's not a solution, it's not a patch, it's a process. And I think that this is I always say that I think the zero in zero trust is kind of overwhelming, because I think people think that means you're supposed to get to like zero vulnerabilities or zero chance. And it's just the whole never trust, always verify. And we need to emphasize that like this is a journey that you're constantly going to be on, because especially right now with things like non-human identities and all of these crazy different they're not quite humans, but they're not quite machines, and they're doing probabilistic things instead of deterministic things. Zero trust is going to have to continue to evolve with you, and you're going to have to continue to evolve with it as, you know, things rapidly change. So I just want to PSA, because I think that there's sometimes other vendors, and you guys are great about this, but other zero trust vendors would be like, you know, you just need zero trust and then all your problems are solved. There'll be no lateral movement. You'll be able to keep up with everything. And it's just not the case, right?
Yeah. So you said it nicely. Zero trust is a process. It's a journey. And you need to go through those phases that I described earlier as well. And it is increasingly more important, especially in this day and age where you're going to see those agents being leveraged by threat actors. They don't sleep. They're working 24/7. And they're able to take those attack paths that human adversaries won't. So there's a lot of unknown unknowns that we're going to run into when we see these agents trying to go after it. And look, good guys are also going to leverage the same technology to protect themselves. So it will be definitely interesting next few years.
I gave a talk on like the benefits and drawbacks of AI and security, and it was literally identical on each column. It was like accelerated pace of innovation, like, and on the drawbacks, it was like attackers have all of these things too. Well, I want to plug you doing a couple things here. I know you have a talk or two that you're giving, so tell us about what you're doing at Black Hat.
I'll be giving a talk on our ransomware report. We will be actually diving deep into the prevalent ransomware families that we saw, their tactics. We will be doing a demo of the attack chain that I mentioned, where there's an AI-based help desk bot making a phone call. It's a slide-based walkthrough, but it kind of showcases multiple tactics that we have seen several ransomware operators leverage successfully in conducting their attacks over the last couple of years. And then, of course, we'll end the talk by giving real-world advice that we've seen work very well in defending against these type of tactics, the attacks that we're seeing out there.
I love that, because I think there's a lot of FUD, right, a lot of vendors, but to actually see this is what really happened, this is what you can really do to prevent it, that's fantastic. Deepen, thank you so much for joining us. Really appreciate it. It was a fantastic conversation. I'm sure we'll have you back again. Really timely information for people.
Thank you for inviting me. I really enjoyed it. Thank you.
Thank you. And thank you for tuning in. From Las Vegas, Nevada, Black Hat 2025, this is Jackie McGuire. Stay tuned. We will be back with lots more interviews, updates, and fantastic guests. Thanks.